Chapter 11, Domicile of Particular Persons, Infants, SS 228. We have already seen that at birth the infant, if legitimate, receives as his own the domicile of his father, and how the question of legitimacy is to be determined has already been discussed. If he is illegitimate or posthumous, he receives the domicile of his mother, and if neither father nor mother be known, he is presumed to be domiciled where he is found, at least until his place of birth or his parentage be shown. If he is born illegitimate and is legitimated by the subsequent marriage of his parents, he thereupon receives the domicile of his father. And such domicile, that is, domicile of origin or domicile conferred by subsequent legitimation, is presumed to continue until the contrary is shown. This leads us to inquire how the domicile of an infant may be changed. SS 229. Domicile of infant cannot be changed by his own act. And first, it cannot, at least ordinarily, be changed by his own act. Infants are deemed in law to be wanting in discretion, and, therefore, without capacity to form the intention requisite for the establishment of a domicile of choice. Hence it results that until they arrive at such age as is deemed by the particular law to which they are subject sufficient for them, attribution to them of capacity to choose and act for themselves, they must either retain the domicile which they received at birth, or must depend upon other persons for a change of domicile. Indeed, it has been laid down by a good authority as the undisputed position of all jurists, that a minor cannot of his own accord, or, to use the expression of Bankershoop, proprium art, change his domicile. This is undoubtedly the general rule, and it cannot be said that there are in the law as understood and administrated in England and America any well-established exceptions. SS 230, Roman Law. The Roman law does not help us much on this subject. Familias must have been with the consent, express or tacit, of the father. However, inasmuch as the patria potestas extended not only to children of tender years, but also to those of mature age and to their children, and ended only with the death of the father or the emancipation of the child, the Roman law furnishes us on this subject no fair analogy from which we can draw authority for the modern doctrine. SS 231. The rule of disability sometimes stated in this country in a qualified form. The rule of disability has, in this country, been frequently stated, probably from an abundance of caution, as applicable to unemancipated minors, and in settlement cases it has been held that an emancipated minor may acquire a settlement for himself. But the latter doctrine is a legacy of the English law of pauper settlements into which the doctrine of domicile does not enter, and which rests upon its own peculiar grounds, largely statutory. These cases are therefore not authorities even for the doctrine that an emancipated minor may change his municipal domicile. Much less can they have any weight in determining the question of his capacity to change his national or quasi-national domicile. Emancipation, as understood in this country, relates mainly to the right of the minor to acquire a settlement for himself, and to his right to receive and dispose of his own earnings, and is not to be understood to clothe him with any legal capacity, except such as is actually necessary for his maintenance and protection, and, if married, for the maintenance and protection of his family. Whatever, therefore, might be held with regard to his power to change his municipal domicile, the consequences of a change of national or quasi-national domicile are of such a serious nature that it seems dangerous to allow him to change such domicile until he has arrived at the full age of discretion. SS-232, is there any exception in favor of a married minor? Pothier, while holding that a minor may not transfer his domicile at his will, says that he nevertheless may in certain cases, one of which is when he marries with the consent of those under whose power he is, in which case he may transfer his domicile to the place where he takes his wife, and he may also, after he is married, transfer it wherever it seems good to him. And this seems to have been a well-recognized principle in the old French law. In a Texas case, this question was raised, but not directly decided. Among the English text writers, Fillmore goes beyond the doctrine of Pothier, and says it can scarcely be doubted that in Great Britain a minor once married, whether with or without the proper consent, would be held capable of choosing his domicile. Westlake, in his first edition, holds it to be clear that a married minor must be treated as sui juris in respect of domicile, since on his marriage he actually founds an establishment separate from the parental home. And Foote approves this expression, adding that, in such case the question would appear to be one of fact, and if the minor, after the ceremony of marriage, continued to reside with his or her parents, there would be no occasion to consider it, inasmuch as there would be only one locality to which the domicile could possibly be attributed. In his second edition, Westlake says, if it is asked whether the condition of full age is necessary in the case of those who have once been emancipated by marriage, the answer will be that it must depend upon the personal law. A minor who, on marriage, is relieved by the law of his country from all incapacity, will, of course, be as capable for the purpose of changing his domicile as for any other purpose. Such, however, is not the law of England, and perhaps the true view could not be better stated than in his words. Dicey opposes the former view taken by Westlake, and declares that the reasoning, by which the suggested exception to the disability of the minor is supported, is unsatisfactory and unsound, inasmuch as it involves some confusion between domicile and residence, and derives no support from the view taken by English law as to an infant's liability on his contracts, which is in no way affected by his marriage. He further holds the existence of the exception itself to be open to the gravest doubt. And certainly, unless we are prepared to hold that the place where a married man resides with his family is universally and necessarily the place of his domicile, there seems to be no good reason for attributing to a married minor the capacity to select for himself a domicile, which is denied to an unmarried minor. This view is reinforced by the Massachusetts settlement case of Taunton v. Plymouth, where it was held that a married minor cannot gain a settlement in a town by residence there. SS-233. Other exceptions suggested. Pothier mentions several other cases in which the minor is capable of changing his domicile, namely, when he is provided with a benefice, or a charge, or other employment from which he is not removable, and which requires perpetual residence, or when, with the consent of those under whose power he establishes a house of commerce at a place. This last case has received some support in Great Britain from the Irish case of Stevens v. McFarlane, the grounds of which, however, are somewhat obscure, and the case itself is inconclusive. SS-234, an emancipated minor, an exception under the French Code Civil. An emancipated minor may, under the modern French law, choose a domicile for himself. The code provides, the minor not emancipated shall have his domicile at the home of his father and mother, or tutor, and further, by its terms, marriage operates as an irrevocable emancipation of a minor, and clothes him with large powers in the management of his affairs. By its terms, also emancipation may be conferred upon a minor, 3, but this is revocable. SS-235. The domicile of the minor follows that of his father during the life of the latter. The father is the head of the family as long as he lives, and just as his domicile attracts to it that of his wife, so, too, it draws after it, through all of its changes, the domicile of his infant legitimate child. This attraction is the conclusion or inference which the law draws from the parental relation, and in general may be said to be wholly independent of the fact of the actual residence of the child. So long as the child dwells with and is a member of the family of his father, it goes without saying that they have the same domicile. Gibson, C. J., in the leading case of school directors v. James, says, no infant, who has a parent sui juris, can, in the nature of things, have a separate domicile. This springs from the status of marriage, which gives rise to the institution of families, the foundation of all the domestic happiness and virtue which is to be found in the world. The nurture and education of the offspring make it indispensable that they be brought up in the bosom, and as a part of their parents' family, without which the father could not perform the duties he owes them, or receive from them the service that belongs to him. In every community, therefore, they are an integral part of the domestic economy, and the family continues, for a time, to have a local habitation and a name after its surviving parents' death. The parents' domicile, therefore, is consequently and unavoidably the domicile of the child. SS 236, ID, even though the infant does not dwell with his father, the result would be the same, even though father and child dwell apart. Although, as we have seen, this was not the rule in the Roman law. It is thoroughly settled in modern law that the domicile of the child follows the domicile of his father. If the child does not migrate with his father, it has never been held that the domicile of the former remains unchanged, neither has it been held that the father can set up for his child a domicile different from his own. And the language of the authorities is such and so strong that it seems impossible to put upon any other construction than that the domicile of the child is necessarily that of the father, at least so long as the former remains in any manner under the guardianship and control of the latter. SS 237, ID, possible exception. A case may be supposed, however, in which it would seem unjust to apply this general rule of derivation, e.g., where a father has abandoned his child and has emigrated to a foreign country or a distant state. Under extreme circumstances, in such a case a court might, and probably would, refuse to seek in a distant land a domicile for the child with a parent who had been faithless to parental duty, or, if it did recognize such domicile, refuse to attach to it the usual legal consequences. And we might possibly go a step farther and apply the same principle to cases of municipal domicile where there has been desertion on the part of the father. But such doctrine would be applied, doubtless, only in extreme cases. Upon the separation of the father and mother, the domicile of the father continues to be that of their child, even though the latter accompanies and dwells with his mother. SS 238. Upon the death of the father, the domicile of the infant follows that of his mother. Upon the death of the father, usually the mother becomes the head of the family, and it would seem but natural and proper that henceforth her infant children should depend upon her for their domicile, at least as long as she remains an independent person and capable of choosing her own domicile. And this, with certain qualifications and limitations, has generally been admitted both by continental and Anglo-American jurists, although the question has been somewhat complicated by considering it along with the question of the power of a guardian to change the domicile of his minor ward. Indeed, little has been said against it, beyond the denial implied in the assertion by some jurists that the infant child retains the domicile of the father after the death of the latter. But this assertion has usually been made either carelessly or in view of the fact of the father surviving the mother. John Vogt affirms the power of the mother as well as the father to change the domicile of the infant child. Plain CSM the minor and he sit, pater vel mater vidua domicilium mutante, filium esium vidra mutes. See it, it's translatus sit, nec ex prioris sit novi domicilii, a pater matra of recenter, constituti, jure sensori in dubio deber, rationis est. So also does Pothier, speaking with his usual clearness and force. After denying the power of the guardian to change the domicile of his ward, he says, it is not the same with the mother, the parental power being, in our law, different from that of the Roman law, common to the father and mother. The mother, after the death of her husband, succeeds to the rights and the quality of head of the family which her husband had with regard to their infant children. Her domicile, wherever she determines to transfer it without fraud, ought then to be that of her infant children until they are able to choose one for themselves. SS 239, ID, British authorities, Pottinger v. Whiteman. In England, the question arose in the case of Pottinger v. Whiteman at the rolls before Sir William Grant, who held the mother competent to change the domicile of her children. It is true that she had been appointed by the court of the domicile of the children, their guardian. His Honor, however, seems to have laid little stress upon this fact, but to have held the mother's competency qua mother. The facts were that the father, a native of England, died domiciled in the island of Guernsey, leaving a widow and 7 infant children living at the time of his decease, 4 of them being his children by a former marriage. The widow was appointed by the royal court of Guernsey guardian of her own infant children, and afterwards removed to England, bringing them with her. Upon the subsequent death of two of her children in infancy, the question arose as to the distribution of their personal estate, whether it was distributable according to the law of Guernsey where their father was domiciled at the time of his death, or according to that of England where their mother had subsequently become domiciled. In delivering his opinion, the learned master of the rolls said, "Here the question is, whether, after the death of the father, children remaining under the care of the mother follow the domicile which she may acquire, or retain that which their father had at his death, until they are capable of gaining one by acts of their own." The weight of authority is certainly in favor of the former proposition. It has the sanction both of Vogt and Bynkershuk, the former, however, qualifying it by a condition that the domicile shall not have been changed, for the fraudulent purpose of obtaining an advantage by altering the rule of succession. Pothier, whose authority is equal to that of either, maintains the proposition as thus qualified. There is an introductory chapter to his treatise on the custom of Orleans, in which he considers several points that are common to all the customs of France, and, among others, the law of domicile. He holds, in opposition to the opinion of some jurists, that a tutor cannot change the domicile of his pupil, but he considers it as clear that the domicile of the surviving mother is also the domicile of the children, provided it be not with a fraudulent view to their succession that she shifts the place of her abode. And he says that such fraud would be presumed if no reasonable motive could be assigned for the change. There never was a case in which there could be less suspicion of fraud than the present. The father and mother were both natives of England. They had no long residence in Guernsey, and after the father's death, there was an end of the only tie which connected the family with that island. That the mother should return to this country and bring her children with her was so much a matter of course, that the fact of her doing so can excite no suspicion of an improper motive. And I think, therefore, the master has rightly found the deceased children to have been domiciled in England. It is consequently by the law of this country that the succession to their personal property must be regulated. This is the leading case upon the subject, and was declared by Lords Lyndhurst and Campbell in Johnstone v. Beatty to be conclusive as to the mother's power to change the domicile of her minor children. The question has never since been reopened in England. Lord Penzance, however, took occasion to say in the late case of Sharp v. Crispin that the better opinion seems to be that, after the father's death, the mother may, by changing her domicile, affect the domicile of her minor children, thus apparently going somewhat beyond the doctrine of Pottinger v. Whiteman, if the effect of that decision be strictly limited to the facts of the case, namely, when the child accompanies the mother to her new place of abode. In Scotland, in Arnott v. Groom, the power of the mother was affirmed under circumstances somewhat similar to those of Pottinger v. Whiteman. The father, a Scotchman by birth, was an officer in the service of the East India Company, and therefore had an Anglo-Indian domicile. Upon his death, his wife returned from India to Scotland, taking with her infant daughter, aged about 1 year. The domicile of the child was subsequently held to be Scotch. SS 240, ID, American Authorities. The mother's power has been repeatedly affirmed in the American decisions, the latest expression being by the Supreme Court of the United States, in Lamar v. Miku, where Gray, J., in delivering the opinion of the court, says, as infants have the domicile of their father, he may change their domicile by changing his own, and after his death the mother, while she remains a widow, may likewise, by changing her domicile, change the domicile of the infants, the domicile of the children, in either case, following the independent domicile of their parent. SS 241, ID. Does the domicile of the infant necessarily follow that of his widowed mother, or may the latter change hers without affecting that of her infant child? But how far the relation between the domicile of the mother and that of her child extends does not seem to be well settled. The language of Gray, J., above quoted, and similar language used by others, seems to place the father and the surviving mother on the same footing with respect to the domicile of their infant children. But, as we have seen, the domicile of the minor child follows that of his father, although the child does not accompany his father to the new abode of the latter. Would the same doctrine apply to the case of the surviving mother? In other words, is there anything in the relation of mother and child which raises a conclusive presumption of identity of domicile, notwithstanding the fact that they dwell apart? It has been said by respectable authority that, where nothing more appears than the removal, in fact, of the mother from one abode to another, the presumption would be that the domicile of the child has followed that of the parent. But WTS, this appears to be nothing more than a presumption of fact, for in the same case it is said to state, however, that the residence of the mother is necessarily the residence of the child, is too broad a position, for the power of effecting a change may very well exist without being exercised, and the mother's residence may be altered, while at the same time she refuses to alter that of the child. But in this case the infant did accompany his widowed mother in her change of residence, and his domicile was held to have followed hers. This statement above quoted must be looked upon, therefore, as a mere statement of opinion, without reference to the facts of the case. By other authorities, however, the dependence of the domicile of the child upon that of his widowed mother has been affirmed, with the proviso that the child accompany the mother to her new place of abode. But is this essential, or is it stated merely out of an abundance of caution? Can she, by carrying with her, or leaving behind her, her minor child, change or not his domicile, as she sees fit, while herself acquiring a new one? No direct answer has been given to this question by any authoritative decision, and the conflicting language of the courts and of text writers leaves it an open one, although the weight of authority seems to be in the negative. But furthermore, assuming that she can leave in statu quo the domicile of her infant child while changing her own, can she change it by sending him to reside at some new place without at the same time changing her own? The two cases are not identical, for it will readily be seen that it is one thing for an English mother to leave her child domiciled in England, while she herself changes her domicile to France or one of the American states, or for a Pennsylvania mother to leave her child domiciled in that state, while she herself removes to Massachusetts, and quite another for a mother, by sending her child to another state or country, without herself accompanying him, to confer upon him a domicile there. In the one case she would be merely leaving in statu quo a dependent domicile derived by the child from herself or his father, and in the other she would be conferring upon him an entirely new domicile, and one which would be independent of the domicile of anyone else. The latter position has, the writer believes, never been affirmed with respect to the father, and a fortiori can scarcely be held with respect to the mother. SS 242, ID, is the qualification that the mother must act without fraud, a valid one. Another qualification is frequently put by the authorities. It is frequently said that the surviving mother may change the domicile of her children, if she act without fraud. This qualification is stated by numerous jurists, and in many of the cases, and the particular fraud, which is usually feared and pointed out to be guarded against, is a fraudulent attempt to alter the distribution of the infant's personal estate. The language which they use is applicable as well to the father as to the mother, but the authorities differ among themselves as to the extent to which such fraudulent intent must be shown, Pothier, perhaps, taking the most extreme position of any. He says, there would be fraud if there should appear no other reason for the translation of her domicile than that of procuring some advantage in the personal succession of her infants, thus, apparently, throwing the burden of proof, to show good faith on the part of the mother, upon those alleging the change of the child as domicile. John Vogt puts the case of a minor who is in ill health at the time of his removal, and holds that such circumstance would of itself be indicative of fraud, if by the change of domicile the succession is altered. SS 243, ID, ID, but with submission to the great learning and ability of the jurists who have held the opinion just referred to, it seems to the writer all important to distinguish between a change of domicile and the legal consequences of such a change. For it is one thing to hold that a change has taken place, and another thing to restrain the legal consequences of such change in the interests of justice, so that the fraud which was designed shall not be consummated. Suppose that, for the purpose of effecting the personal succession, a mother carries with her infant child into another state or a foreign country, and the child, instead of dying there, should live and grow up to maturity. Can it be doubted that his general legal capacity would be determined by the laws of the new place? Can it be doubted that his personal property would be taxable there, etc., if negative answers are given to these questions? They must be given upon the assumption that a change of domicile has taken place. And yet, as we have seen, A person cannot have a separate domicile for each particular purpose to which the principle of domicile is applicable. It seems, therefore, more logical to hold that, while courts would interpose to defeat the fraudulent design with which a parent had attempted to change the domicile of his or her infant child, they would not do so upon the ground that the change of domicile had not been accomplished, but rather upon the ground that, in the particular case, the usual legal effect could not be given to the change of domicile, so as to assist in the perpetration of the fraud. SS 244. The power of the mother does not extend beyond her widowhood, but the surviving mother is capable of changing the domicile of her infant children only during her widowhood. Upon her remarriage, she loses her headship of the family of her former husband and passes under the power of her second husband. Her domicile merges in his, and she is no longer legally competent to exercise the choice necessary for the establishment of a domicile. Her domicile is now itself derivative, and is, therefore, no longer capable of being communicated to her minor children. They retain the last domicile which they had during her widowhood, says Pothier, but when she remarries, although she acquires the domicile of her second husband, into whose family she passes, this domicile of her second husband will not be that of her infant children, who do not pass, as she does, into the family of their stepfather. This is why they are considered to continue to have their domicile at the place where their mother had hers before she remarried, just as they would be considered to preserve it if she were dead. Gibson, C. J., in the case already quoted from, says, a husband cannot properly be said to stand in the relation of a parent to his wife's children by a previous marriage, where they have means of support which are independent of the mother, in whose place he stands for the performance of her personal duties, because a mother is not bound to support her impotent children so long as they are of ability to support themselves. Neither can they derive the domicile of a subsequent husband from her, because her new domicile is itself a derivative one, and a consequence of the merger of her civil existence. Her domicile is his, because she has become a part of him, but the same thing cannot be said of her children. Having no personal existence for civil purposes, she can impart no right or capacity which depends on a state of civil existence, and the domicile of her children continues, after a second marriage, to be what it was before it. In a West Virginia case, it was held that the domicile of the children of a remarried mother did not follow hers, even though she had been appointed by the will of their father their testamentary guardian. It makes no difference that they continue to reside with her. She has passed into another family, into which they do not follow her. And although they may reside with the family of their stepfather, they do not become a part of it, and are not subject or immediately to his control. SS 244A. Domicile of illegitimate children. With respect to the illegitimate child, it is not only true that he takes his domicile of origin from his mother, but also that his domicile follows hers throughout all its changes, at least so long as she remains unmarried. In France, however, the domicile of the natural child is held to depend upon his recognition by his parents, and follows the domicile of the parent who recognizes him. SS 245. Upon the death of both parents, an infant may acquire the domicile of a grandparent. Upon the death of his parents, the infant usually retains the last domicile which they, or the survivor of them, had. But this is not always true. In the late case of Lamar v. Miku, the Supreme Court of the United States held the domicile of infants, whose parents were both dead, to be changed by their going into another state to reside with their grandmother. Gray, J., said, although some books speak only of the father, or, in case of his death, the mother, as guardian by nature, it is clear that the grandfather or grandmother, when the next of kin, is also such a guardian. In the present case, the infants, when their mother died and they went to the home of their paternal grandmother, were under 10 years of age. The grandmother, who appears to have been their only surviving grandparent and their next of kin, and whose only living child, an unmarried daughter, resided with her, was the head of the family, and upon the facts agreed, it is evident that the removal of the infants, after the death of their parents, to the home of their grandmother in Georgia, was with Lamar's consent. Under these circumstances, there can be no doubt that, by taking up their residence with her, they acquired her domicile in that state. The Supreme Court of Georgia, in Darden v. Wyatt, held that the maternal grandfather of an infant, whose parents were both dead, might change the residence of the infant from one county to another, so as to vest in the ordinary of the latter county jurisdiction to appoint a guardian. It must be observed that in both of these cases the infant became actually resident with the grandparent and a part of the family of the latter. Whether the power of the grandparent would extend to an infant not dwelling with such grandparent may well be doubted. In a Louisiana case, minors were, by a family arrangement, taken from the state of Louisiana, where their parents had died domiciled, and placed to live with their father as brother and sister in other states, their paternal grandfather being alive and taking part in the arrangement. Upon these facts, it was held that their domicile remained unchanged. The case turned largely, however, upon a construction of the Louisiana Code, as between two ancestors of equal degree, probably that one would have the power to change the domicile who first got possession of the infant, and with whom the latter actually resided. SS 246, Domicile of an Apprentice, in Maddox v. This state, a case involving the right to vote, the Supreme Court of Indiana held that the residence of the master is the residence of the apprentice, for every purpose known to the law, and whilst a minor, the apprentice could not, by leaving his master and going to another state, change that residence. SS 247, Adopted Child. By adoption, as it is practiced in many of the states of this union, the adopted child passes into the family and under the control of the person or persons adopting him, and in his relations with them enjoys most of the rights and is subject to most of the duties which belong to a child born in lawful wedlock. It would seem to follow that such child, upon adoption, would receive as his own the domicile of his adoptive parents, and that his domicile would follow theirs throughout his infancy, in the same manner as if he were their child by nature. But reasonable as this conclusion appears, the writer has not been able to find any authority decisively in point. The Roman law, under which adoption was extensively practiced, is silent with regard to its effect upon domicile, although it treats of its effect upon origo, imposing upon the adopted son a double citizenship, viz., both that of his father and that of the person adopting him. This rule was doubtless due to a desire to prevent a person from exchanging the more grievous burdens of one community for the lighter burdens of another. Therefore, while the Roman law refused to relieve an adopted person from the burdens which belonged to him by reason of his natural parentage, it considered the relationship of the adopting and adopted person so close that it imposed upon the latter the citizenship, with all its grievous incidents. Of the former, probably the explanation of the silence of the Roman law with regard to the effect of adoption upon domicile is found in the fact that, by that law, the domicile of the child did not necessarily follow that of his father by nature, and hence could scarcely be held to follow that of his adoptive father. We have, therefore, no light from that law upon our subject, except such as is drawn by the aforetory argument from the effect of adoption upon citizenship. Keeping in view the altered modern rule of the dependence of the domicile of the child upon that of his parent. After the downfall of the Roman Empire, adoption fell into disrepute in most of the European countries, especially in those from which we have received the ablest and most elaborate discussions of the conflict of laws. As might be expected, these discussions are silent upon our subject. The Code Civil, however, provides for adoption, as do the positive laws of many of the other European states. But while the jurists of these countries have considered its effect upon naturalization with somewhat conflicting results, they appear to be silent on the subject of its effect upon domicile. SS 248, ID. In this country, in the Massachusetts case of Ross v. Ross, the language of Gray, J., in delivering the opinion of the court, incidentally assumes that where the adoptive father has changed his domicile from one state to another, taking with him his adopted child, the domicile of the latter is thereby changed. In Foley's estate, in the Philadelphia Orphans Court, a briefly reported case in which the question was as to the distribution of the personal estate of a minor, Dwight J. said the decedent was a minor at the time of her death in this city, Mary Hamblett, who had adopted her under the Massachusetts statute in 1858, was then, and also at the time of the deceased's death, domiciled in that state. So, too, Thomas Quinn, the father of the minor. In either case, we think the minor also had her domicile in Massachusetts, and he then proceeded to distribute the fund in court according to the Massachusetts law. SS 249 has a guardian power to change the domicile of his minor ward. We proceed now to consider the vexed question of the relation of a guardian to the domicile of his ward. This subject has been discussed with great learning and ability and at great length by the continental jurists, as well as by those of Great Britain in this country. The views expressed have been conflicting, and in many instances wholly irreconcilable, and the doctrine, notwithstanding the thorough discussion to which it has been subjected, still remains involved in difficulty and doubt. SS 250, ID, Continental Authorities in the Affirmative. Bainkershuk has discussed the subject at great length, having devoted a whole chapter of his Quaestiones Juris Privati to it. He declares that he is not aware that the power of a guardian to change the domicile of his ward, just the same as a surviving parent may change that of a child, has been seriously doubted by anyone except where the question of personal succession is considered. For, he adds, where this question is considered, there is much dispute. He gives it as his own opinion that a guardian must be held to have such power, even in cases where the question of personal succession is raised, and moreover he refuses to admit an exception, even in cases of fraud. In this last respect, however, his opinion stands by itself, and is put upon the rather sophistical grounds. First, that the parents can, if they see fit, guard against a change in the succession by an antenuptial agreement or a testament. And second, that it is impossible from the nature of the case to lay down any general rule for determining what shall be sufficient evidence of a fraudulent change of domicile. Burgundis, upon the authority of Bartalis, appears to hold that the domicile of the guardian is also that of his ward, whether they dwell together or not. Rodenberg, speaking with special reference to the law which determines minority and majority, holds that a guardian may change the domicile of his ward provided fraud or prejudice to third parties are absent. Brentonier holds that, with reference to testamen, teri capacity, the minor follows the domicile of his guardian. Cochin is cited as an authority for the dependence of the domicile of the minor upon that of his guardian. But it is worthy of note that in the case of the Marquisin, Pater, in which he appears to assume this ground the guardian was the maternal grandfather of the ward. Vogt, as we have already seen, holds the same opinion with regard to the power of a guardian to change the domicile of his ward as he holds with regard to the power of a parent to change the domicile of his or her infant child. Namely, that either of the persons named may, if acting without fraud, change the domicile of the minor by changing his or her own domicile and carrying the minor along to the new place of abode. The opinion of Boulenlot is difficult to extract from his rather loose and apparently conflicting expressions. On the one hand, he admits that there is no inconvenience in reputing a minor to be domiciled where his guardian is domiciled as to the particular faculties which the law of that domicile may give him, so that if by the law of the domicile of the guardian, he has the power to make a testament of his movables, he may make one conformable to that law, holding that it is but just that in such case one who is domiciled, even though a minor, should be subject to the purely real laws of the place where he is domiciled without fraud. But, on the other hand, he denies the right to the guardian to change the personal succession of the minor, and lays down as a general rule, a minor, out of the domicile of his father, with his tutor, dwells with him, but he is not properly domiciled with him. He sojourns there awaiting his majority, and he likens him to a suitor awaiting the result of his lawsuit. The French code provides, as we have seen, that the unemancipated minor shall have his domicile at the home of his father and mother or tutor. The Louisiana Civil Code contains a similar provision, but its effect is substantially restrained to municipal domicile, it being held that, inasmuch as an appointed tutor forfeits his tutorship by removing from the state, the provision is inapplicable to a change of quasi-national domicile. Barr holds that the alteration of the domicile of a minor ward can only take place with the approval of the supreme authority charged with the guardianship, but under this limitation a minor may undoubtedly change his domicile through his guardian. SS 251, ID, in the negative. But, on the other hand, many of the continental jurists have denied the power of the guardian to change the domicile of his infant ward. Mornack, speaking with special reference to personal succession, and while admitting the existence of authority on the other side, says, Privoluit viro aerum sententia, qui domicilium minoris precedent eo casu in loco origines, IDSD in edibus, paternis ac maternis collocandum dicerunt, cum enim domicilium quatuor modis contra hi solat, natura, ac origin, Item voluntate, aci concilio, deign convention, aut ex necessitate munerus. Solium ex his naturel domicilium minori superust, locus solicit, in quo ips coverit, parentes defesserent, absurdunc aliat furet a finger minori inquiris, quod ips per ide de non habet eligendi nymph domicilii consulium. I am moet priestereter ansa inter dum tutoribus fraudandi viros mobilium minoris interuntis herids transferent to basilicit domicilium in loca, quibus successora sibi vidrant ex. Patriis moribus, interunt valetudinario minor desideria. Christinius lays down the same doctrine, using almost the very words of Mornach. Balhier holds that the domicile of a minor cannot be changed by his guardian, unless the latter be an ascendant. Denizart says, minors, even after the death of their father, have no other domicile than that which their father had. This they retain always, until they become either majors or married, without their kinsfolk or guardian being able to change it, because they may not disturb the order of succession regulated by the domicile. Pothier, speaking with his usual clearness, says, after citing the several authorities pro and con, it suffices us to say that minors do not compose the family of their guardian as infants compose the family of their father. They are in the house of their guardian as in the house of a stranger. They are there ad tempus, for the time that the guardianship ought to last. Consequently, the domicile of their guardian is not their true domicile, and they cannot be considered to have any other than the parental domicile until they become of age to establish, and have effectively established, one for themselves by their own choice. And, according to Demelon, it was generally held, prior to the adoption of the Code Civil, that a guardian, the father or the mother accepted, was not able to change the domicile of his minor ward. Merlin says that in the old law the only doubt was as to the power of a guardian who was an ascendant. For it was unanimously agreed that a guardian who was a stranger in blood or a collateral relative had no power to change the domicile of his ward. SS 252, ID, English text writers. In England, among the text writers, Fuddle affirms the dependence of the domicile of the minor ward upon that of his guardian. Dicey it considers it doubtful, and Westlake appears on both sides of the question. In his first edition, he holds that the domicile of an unmarried infant, boy or girl, follows that of the mother or guardian after the father's death and that of the guardian after the death of both parents, while in his second edition he says, a guardian, whether appointed by the father under or by that law or jurisdiction itself, cannot change his ward as domicile, except so far as he may be permitted to do so by the terms of his appointment, or by the law or public authority under which he holds his office, admitting an exception, however, in the case of the mother, when she is the guardian, and the appointment or law under which she holds expresses nothing to the contrary. SS 253, ID, American text writers. In this country we have on the one side the high authority of Kent declaring, it would rather seem to me that, if there be no competent parent living, and the guardian be duly appointed, he may and ought, when acting in good faith and reasonably in his character of guardian, to be able to shift the infant's domicile with his own, and that the foreign authorities to that point have the best reason on their side. The objection against the guardian as power, in such a case, appears to me to be two: refined and speculative. On the other side, we have the equally high authority of Story, who says, in the case of a change of domicile by a mere guardian, not being a parent, it is extremely difficult to find any reasonable principle on which it can be maintained that he can, by any change of domicile, change the right of succession to the minor's property. The reasoning of Bainkershuk upon the point is very unsatisfactory, while that of Mornach, Balhier, and Pothier has solid reason and justice to sustain it. Wharton also takes the negative side of the question, at least so far as it concerns succession, contending, however, that the technical form of the minor is always, and unquestionably, that of the parent or guardian. It thus appears that the opinions of the text writers are about equally divided, both in point of number and authority. SS 254, ID, no direct decision in England. English jurisprudence furnishes no decided case in elucidation of our subject. The case of Pottinger v. Whiteman has been frequently cited in this country as though it decided that a guardian, qua guardian, could change the domicile of his ward from one state or country to another, but careful examination discloses that no such doctrine was there held. In that case, the mother happened also to be the guardian, But it was qua mother that Sir William Grant held her entitled to change the domicile of her infant children. Moreover, it is noteworthy that, in reaching his conclusion, he relied strongly upon the authority of Pothier, and pointed out that while that jurist considers it as clear that the domicile of the surviving mother is also the domicile of the children, provided it be not with the fraudulent view to their succession that she shifts the place of her abode, he holds, in opposition to the opinion of some jurists, that a tutor cannot change the domicile of his pupil, that this is the view of Pottinger v. Whiteman taken by the English judges is apparent from the remarks of Lords Lyndhurst and Campbell in Johnstone v. Biddy and Douglas v. Douglas. Wickens v. C. took occasion to say during the argument, "It seems doubtful whether a guardian can change an infant's domicile. The difficulty is that a person may be guardian in one place and not in another." SS 255. ID. American Decisions. Natural guardian may change the domicile of his infant ward. The subject has been discussed in a number of cases in this country with much conflict of opinion as the result. We have already seen that a natural guardian may change the domicile of his or her ward, and who are to be deemed natural guardians has already been stated. SS 256. ID. ID. The domicile of the guardian is not necessarily that of his infant ward. The domicile of the guardian is not necessarily that of his ward. This was decided in School Directors v. James Gibson, C. J., delivering an opinion of great clearness and cogency, in which he said, "A ward is not naturally or necessarily a part of his guardian as family, and though the guardian may appoint the place of the ward's residence, it may be, and usually is, a place distinct from his own. When an infant has no parent, the law remits him to his domicile of origin or to the last domicile of his surviving parent. And why should this natural and wholesome relation be disturbed by the coming in of a guardian, when a change of the infant's domicile is not necessary to the accomplishment of any one purpose of the guardianship? A guardian has indeed power over his ward as person in residence, but it follows not that the ward's domicile must attend that of his guardian, for there is nothing in a state of pupilage which requires it to do so. We are of opinion, then, that the domicile of a ward is not necessarily the domicile of his guardian." This was a case of municipal domicile involving the question of taxation, and the precise point determined was that the personal property of the wards was not taxable in the borough in which the guardian was domiciled, the wards residing with their mother in another municipal division, where also their father had been domiciled at the time of his death. In a late New York case involving a question of testamentary capacity, it was held that the domicile of the ward does not follow that of the guardian. In this case, the parents of the deceased ward were at the time of their death domiciled in New York, where she continued to reside until her death, her guardian being domiciled in New Jersey, and it was held that her domicile continued to be in New York, and that her testamentary capacity must be determined by the law of that state. This doctrine is still further reinforced by the cases of Cutts v. Haskins and Holyoke v. Haskins, in which the domicile of the guardian and that of his non-composed ward were held to be different. SS 257. ID. ID. Guardian may change the municipal domicile of his ward. It appears to be pretty well settled that a guardian may change the municipal domicile of his infant ward. In Ex parte Bartlett, this point was raised in Bradford, Surrogate, in a learned opinion, while doubting the authority of the guardian to change his ward's domicile from one state to another, held that he had authority to change her domicile from one county to another within the same state, so as to divest the surrogate of the former county of jurisdiction to appoint the guardian's successor, and to confer it upon the surrogate of the latter county. In Kirkland v. Wutterly, the Supreme Court of Massachusetts held that a minor may, with the consent of his guardian, change his domicile from one town to another within the same state, and thus shift the place where he is liable to personal taxation. The doctrine of this case, although it was doubted by Gibson, C. J., and School Directors v. James, and to a certain extent contradicted by the Missouri case of Marhinek v. Grothaus, is further supported by the cases of Cutts v. Haskins, Holyoke v. Haskins, and Anderson v. Anderson, hereafter to be noticed, in which similar authority was held to belong to guardians of non-compotes. SS 258. ID. ID. Power to change national or quasi-national domicile. Cases in the affirmative. The cases in which it has been declared competent for the guardian to change the domicile of his ward from one state to another are indeed few, although some of them assert such competency with great positiveness. In the Ohio case of Pedden v. Robs, Adam R. Grint, J. says, although it wasn't a greatly controverted question, yet it is now settled that he has even a right to change the domicile of his ward. Poninger v. Whiteman, the reason of the doubt was that the exercise of the right would put it into the power of a guardian to change the succession to the personal property of his ward, a reason which, although it seems to have had great weight with some of the civil law lawyers, has never entitled itself to much with English or American jurists. But the authority upon which he bases his opinion that the question has been settled in favor of the power of the guardian, namely Poninger v. Whiteman, has, as we have already seen, no direct bearing upon the subject. Moreover, the question before the court was the liability of the personal representative of a deceased guardian to be sued by the ward for an account in Ohio, the guardian having been appointed in Pennsylvania. Furthermore, it is noteworthy that in this case the guardian was also the father of the ward. Similar language was used by Flandrau, J., in Townsend v. Kendall, a case of false imprisonment against a foreign guardian for taking into his custody and attempting to carry back to his domicile in Ohio a ward who had been removed from that state by his remarried mother. He says, it is quite well settled in England and the United States that a guardian may change the residence of his ward from one state or country to another, when that change will be for the benefit of the ward story as conflict of L. Sec. 506. And this, though it may change the nature of the succession of the infant's estate should he die in his new domicile, but the least suspicion of fraud would be closely scrutinized by a court of chancery. This consideration, however, does not affect the existence of the power in the guardian, but only goes to the proper and faithful exercise of it. The power has been clearly recognized in the following English and American cases: Poninger v. Whiteman, Gere v. O'Daniel, Cutts v. Haskins, Holyoke v. Haskins, Wood v. Wood, Pedden v. Rods, Adam R. The latter case is very much in point, but the cases which he cites do not bear him out in his position. Poninger v. Whiteman has already been discussed. Cutts v. Haskins and Holyoke v. Haskins were, as we have already seen, cases of municipal domicile. In Gere v. O'Daniel, although it is sometimes cited as an authority upon this question, the power of a guardian over the domicile of his ward was not decided, discussed, or alluded to in any way. The language of Rush, president, was, a minor, during pupilage, cannot acquire a domicile of his own. His domicile, therefore, follows that of his father, and remains until he acquires another, which he cannot do until he becomes a person sui juris. Which language, if it bears upon our subject at all, must be taken to deny rather than affirm the power of a guardian. In Wood v. Wood, a father, domiciled in New York at the time of his death, appointed a testamentary guardian for his children who were of tender age, and directed him to remove them to the state of Ohio. The widow, refusing to accompany them to Ohio, and asking to have them remain with her in the state of New York, Walworth, Chancellor, restrained him from removing them from the latter until further order. The question of their domicile was not raised, but certain language used by the Chancellor has been thought by some to give support to the theory which maintains the power of the guardian to change his ward's domicile. It would seem, however, particularly in view of the authorities which he cites, and which relate to the custody and control of minors by their father and his right to appoint their place of residence, that the learned Chancellor had reference rather to a change of actual residence than to a change of legal residence or domicile. In White v. Howard, the facts were somewhat similar to those of Wood v. Wood, a father domiciled at the time of his death in Connecticut, appointed a testamentary guardian for his daughter, and directed that the latter should, during her minority, reside in New York under the care of her guardian, who also resided there, and there was no circumstance tending to show that the father expected his daughter ever to return to Connecticut. His direction having been carried out, and the daughter having died under age, it was held that her domicile had been changed to New York. But the court, Sutherland, J., delivering the opinion, declined to put its decision upon the ground of the power of the guardian to change the domicile of his ward, basing it upon the manifest intention of the father to change the domicile of his child. Wheeler v. Holly's 6 was in many respects a peculiar case. H. being domiciled in Mississippi, died, leaving a widow and a minor child, E. The widow married W, who was appointed guardian of E. Subsequently, W immigrated from Mississippi to avoid payment of his debts, leaving his guardianship account unsettled, and with his wife took up his residence, first in Texas, and afterwards in Arkansas, taking with him E and her personal property. Under these circumstances, the Supreme Court of Texas held that the domicile of E was changed, but the court, Wheeler, J, delivering the opinion, after arguing strongly and at considerable length in favor of the power of a remarried mother to change the domicile of her child by her first marriage, seems to put the decision upon a concurrence of the maternal control with that of the guardian, apparently relying, however, more strongly upon the former than the latter. In a Flicks estate, Wiley, J., without giving reasons or authorities, declares his opinion that a ward S. domicile may be changed by his guardian as it may be by his parent. But in that case, the change of domicile was decided against, the guardian having been appointed by a court without jurisdiction. Allen, J., who dissented, declined to express any opinion as to the true domicile of the infant. In none of these cases, however, notwithstanding the strong expressions of opinion contained in some of them, was the power of the guardian to change the national or quasi-national domicile of his ward directly and squarely decided. SS 259, ID, cases in the negative. On the negative side of the question, as it relates to national and quasi-national domicile, are several cases. In Ex parte Bartlett, as we have seen, the power of the guardian was doubted. The same doubt was expressed in Sater v. Straub and in School Directors v. James was extended even to cases of municipal domicile. In Colburn v. Holland, Duncan, C. J. declares the question to be unsettled. In Mears v. Sinclair, the Supreme Court of West Virginia held that a testamentary guardian could not change the domicile of her infant ward from one state to another, even though such guardian was the mother, she having remarried. In Daniel v. Hill, the Supreme Court of Alabama met the question squarely and decided against the power of the guardian under these circumstances. The parents of MCA died, domiciled in Alabama when he was only a few months old. His maternal aunt, upon the death of his parents, in pursuance of their request, took the care and control of him, and shortly afterwards her husband, D., was appointed guardian of the infant by the proper court, and MCA remained in their family until his death. After being appointed guardian, D. removed to Mississippi, taking with him his ward, who shortly before his death, and at the age of 18 or 19 years, made a will in favor of D. in wife. By the laws of Alabama he was capable, and by those of Mississippi incapable, of making a will of his personal property at that age. Under these circumstances, the court held him to be domiciled in Alabama, and the will to be valid. Brickle, C. J., in delivering the opinion, remarked, "It is settled in this court that a guardian cannot change the domicile taken by his ward at the place of his birth, or acquired from the father at his death. The testator was born in this state, his parents had their last domicile here, and guardianship of his person and estate was granted by a court of this state. Though he accompanied his guardian to Mississippi on his change of residence to that state, he retained the domicile of his birth, and his testamentary capacity must be measured by the law of this state." Mears v. Sinclair and Daniel v. Hill must both be regarded as direct decisions upon the question under discussion. The latest utterance upon this subject is from the Supreme Court of the United States, in Lamar v. Miku, to the able opinion of Gray, J., in which case reference has already been made. He says, "Further, the ward does not derive a domicile from any other than a natural guardian. A testamentary guardian, nominated by the father, may have the same control of the ward as domicile that the father had. And any guardian, in the state of the domicile of the ward, has been generally held to have the power of changing the ward's domicile from one county to another within the same state, and under the same law. But it is very doubtful, to say the least, whether even a guardian appointed in the state of the domicile of the ward can remove the ward's domicile beyond the limits of the state in which the guardian is appointed, and to which his legal authority is confined. And it is quite clear that a guardian appointed in a state in which the ward is temporarily residing cannot change the ward as permanent domicile from one state to another. SS-260, ID, general results of the American cases. The doctrine which we may extract from the American cases may be thus stated, that a guardian has the power to change the municipal domicile of his ward, that the domicile of the ward is not necessarily that of his guardian, that the natural guardian certainly, and the testamentary guardian probably, has the power to change the national or quasi-national domicile of his ward, unless expressly prohibited by a competent court, that the power of an appointed guardian to change the national or quasi-national domicile of his ward is, to say the least, very doubtful. SS-261. General reasons against the power of the guardian to change the national or quasi-national domicile of his infant ward. It will be observed that most of the discussions on this subject have had, for their ultimate point of controversy, the power of the guardian to affect the personal succession of his ward, and it is customary for those who maintain the negative to argue that he cannot be allowed to change his ward as domicile, because he could thereby control the distribution of the personal estate of the latter in case of his death. But this method of reasoning, as has already been pointed out, is illogical and gives but a limited view of the subject. There are difficulties back of the danger of fraudulent design on the part of the guardian. One of them is that already alluded to in the language of Wickens, v.c. The parental relation is natural and universal, while that of guardianship is artificial, and, to a certain extent at least, local and limited. It is true that among continental jurists it is generally accepted as settled that the guardian appointed by competent authority at the place of the ward's domicile is to be everywhere recognized as by right entitled to the care and custody of ward as person and movable property. Yet this view, in the language of Story, has certainly not received any sanction in America, in the states acting under the jurisprudence of the common law. The rights and powers of guardians are considered as strictly local, and not as entitling them to exercise any authority over the person or personal property of their wards in other states, upon the same general reasoning and policy which have circumscribed the rights and authorities of executors and administrators. It is true that such domiciliary appointment will be considered as an important element in determining the custody of the child, yet the grant of such custody to the foreign guardian is purely in the discretion of the court within whose jurisdiction the child may be found, and will be made or not, according to circumstances, as it appears to be for the best interests of the child, and this is substantially the British doctrine also. SS-262, ID. Again, the authority of a guardian is not only local, but it is also limited. A guardian is but an officer of the court appointing him, is subject to its control and supervision in all things, and has no powers except such as are conferred upon him by his appointment, or by the laws of the place where his appointment is made. The ward is thus under the care of the court, in that it would, under ordinary circumstances, decree or even sanction a change of his domicile, and thus deliver him over to the jurisdiction of foreign laws, seems doubtful. It will allow him to be taken abroad for the benefit of his health, for education, and sometimes even for nurture, but in some cases, only on security being given that he shall be brought back within the jurisdiction when required. It by no means follows that such a change of residence will accomplish a change of domicile, nor will the domiciliary court alone take such view. The courts of the place where the ward is found, having due regard, however, to the welfare and interests of the ward, will sometimes, even though another guardian has been there appointed for him, restore him to the custody of his domiciliary guardian, in order that he may be returned to his own. State or country, or will, under proper circumstances, carry out the directions of the domiciliary court with respect to him, so far as may be consistent with the laws of their own country. But as applications in such matters are not grantable of right, but rather addressed to the discretion of the court, it is apparent that conflict may arise between the courts of several states or countries with respect to the guardianship, custody, and residence of the same minor, as actually occurred in the Dawson case between the New York courts and the English Court of Chancery, and if under such circumstances, necessity should arise for the application of the principle of domicile, for example, to determine his general testamentary capacity, or, in event of his death, his personal succession. Conflicting views with regard to his domicile would doubtless be held by such courts. SS-263, ID. To avoid such perplexities, it seems better to hold strictly to the view that an appointed guardian has no power to change the national or quasi-national domicile of his infant ward without the express direction or consent of the proper domiciliary tribunal appointing him. With respect, however, to a testamentary guardian, it seems reasonable to hold that he may, especially in pursuance of the direction of the deceased father, change the domicile of his infant ward to another state or country, unless expressly prohibited by a competent domiciliary tribunal.